Gospel of Mark. And let's see, we start in verse 2, verses 2 through 20. Mark 13, verses 2 through 20. Or 3 to, sorry. Mark 13, verses 3 through 20. Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple. Peter, James, and John, and Andrew were questioning him privately. Tell us when all these things will be. What will be the sign when all these things are going to be fulfilled? And Jesus began to say to them, see to it that no one misleads you. Many will come in my name saying, I'm the one. Many will mislead many. And when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be frightened. Those things must take place, but it is not yet the end. For nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places and famines. But these are just the start of the birth pangs. So be on your guard, for they will deliver you up to the courts, and you will be flogged in the synagogues, and you will stand before governors and kings for my name's sake as a testimony to them. And the gospel must first be preached to all the nations. And when they arrest you and deliver you up, do not be anxious ahead of time about what you are to say, but say whatever is given to you in that hour, for it will not be you who speak, but rather the Holy Spirit. Yes. Brother will deliver brother to death, father his child, and the children will rise up against parents and cause them to be put to death, and you will be hated by all on account of my name. But it is the one who has endured to the end who will be saved. And when you see the abomination of desolation standing where it should not be, let the reader understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let the one who is on the housetop not go down or enter in to get anything from the house, but rather to flee. And let the one who is in the field not turn back to get a cloak. And woe to those who are with child in those days, or have a baby in those days. Pray that it might not happen in the winter, for those days will be a time of tribulation, such as has not occurred since the beginning of the creation which God created until now, and never shall. And unless the Lord had shortened those days, no life would have been saved. But for the sake of the elect whom God has chosen, God has shortened those days. To look at that text and we see it as a description of the end of the end of the world, the end of all things. But Jesus probably didn't mean that. He meant the end of their world. So you have to understand their world. The apostles who are talking to him, they live in what's called the late Second Temple period. They live in a place where there is a distinctive culture, language, way of being. And even though there's the presence of this sort of pressuring cultural influence from the Romans who are around, they've done a good job of kind of clinging to their way of doing things, their way of being. The temple still functions. The people still dress the way they do. The rabbis still have their traditions to pass on. And the hint, the clue about what Jesus is almost certainly referring to is in that little phrase about when you see the abomination of desolation. So I have to tell you a story that happens about 200 years earlier. It's in the early Second Temple, the early second century. And there, during that time, there was things were changing hands. The Roman Empire was becoming powerful and was starting to exert control, but there was still a lot of leftover things from the kingdoms. Now, when Alexander the Great died in 333 BC, there were his generals. He had four generals who basically divided up his empire into four kingdoms, and one kingdom was called the Seleucid Empire, and one was called the Ptolemaic Empire. The Ptolemaic Empire had kind of Egypt and stuff like that. The Seleucid Empire had more towards Syria, and they would often fight back and forth. And so at one point, there was a Seleucid king. His name was Antiochus Epiphanes IV. Antiochus, some people say Antiochus Epiphanes, but Antiochus. Antiochus was crazy. In fact, the slur was that he was not Epiphanes, but Epimanes, which means the nut job. Epiphanes means God's revelation, but yeah, he didn't mean it that way. Epimanes, the crazy guy. So he was nuts. He actually played Game of Thrones and managed to get the control of the throne, and he established himself as co-king with another person who had actually a better ancestral claim to the throne. He was technically within the sixth line of succession, but he wasn't really the best line of succession. But that person was just a child, so they became co-kings. But the child ended up getting murdered. Yeah, you know, that can happen. You know, you can just fall down the steps and end up with a bunch of knives in your back. I don't know how that occurs. Yeah. So we are literally talking Game of Thrones. And so Antiochus had done battle to get control of Egypt from the Ptolemaic side and had not gone well, so he was not in a good mood. Meanwhile, back in Jerusalem, back in Judea, there was an interesting thing happening. It was a kind of dynamic that you see a lot culturally. Like when the Western world encounters Japan, the Western world gets all excited about things like judo and brings judo over to the United States. Very, very cool. And it's very, very cool. So if you know any, judo was also known back then as jiu-jitsu. And if you go back and you look historically, you'll see that, for example, in England, the suffragettes, right, these are the women arguing for the vote, they were learning jiu-jitsu and throwing the cops around when the cops would try to arrest them. This is actually true. And Teddy Roosevelt was actually a judo player. He had a black belt in judo, and this is early 20th century. Meanwhile, the Japanese are going, oh, baseball, tell us about that. So they were adopting baseball while the United States was adopting judo. And this is a really interesting phenomenon, but it always happens when distinctive cultures meet each other. They borrow back and forth. We still do that to this day. How many of you like to sing karaoke? Anybody like karaoke? There we go. A couple of karaoke singers here. Karaoke is a terrible pronunciation, but that's the common English pronunciation. It's still terrible. It's karaoke, which means to sing out. It's Japanese. We stole it from the Japanese. But you want to know in Japanese filmmaking what they call slow motion? Slow-mo. That's right. It's just so you get this sort of cultural intersection. But you will always get people who want to be more or less one way or the other. So in Judea, there was a bunch of people who were the Judean folks who wanted to be more in the Greek style, the modern way. You know, they're so modern. So they started speaking Greek and really kind of not speaking Aramaic and ignoring the Hebrew and dressing Greek and behaving in Greek ways. And then there was another group who were like the traditionalists, kind of, no, we must hold to our traditions without failure. And they were, they had a little bit of a Taliban-y kind of quality to them, so they wanted everyone else to agree with them. And there was a lot of this sort of tension between the two. Make it Greek. No, keep it true to our old ways. And this created a lot of conflict. And so and Antiochus IV Epiphanes comes back from his defeat in Egypt not in a good mood and finds that there's a powder keg in Judea, so he decides to just go, Judea's going Greek. And among the many things he did, this actually sparks a war, which is called the Maccabean Revolt, but among the many things he did was he sacrificed a pig to Zeus in the temple in Jerusalem. And this came to be known as the abomination of desolation. In the year 70, about 40 years after Jesus is talking, the Romans destroyed the temple in Jerusalem at the beginning part, a few years into what's known as the Jewish War. And once they destroyed the temple, they offered a sacrifice, I think to Caesar, if I recall correctly, as divine, at the altar of the temple in Jerusalem, the abomination of desolation. So Jesus is actually talking about the coming of the destruction of the temple 40 years before it happens. Now, when Mark is writing the gospel, it's much, much closer. The temple's destroyed in the year 75. Mark was writing probably before then, but after the year 65, so it's in a very narrow window of about 5 years. And so the war has already started, what we call the Jewish War has already started. And so for someone like Mark, hearing the prophecy of Jesus from 40 years before, it's incredibly clear what it is we're talking about. And so it's so clear to Mark and to the others around him that Mark puts in a little piece of code for the person whose job it is to read the gospel out loud to the congregation. And you heard me read it. Let the reader understand. What that is that's not for us. That was whoever was reading it for the first time in a congregation had something that was not written down that they were going to stick in there. That was where that was supposed to go. We don't know what it was. But it, my guess is that it was some kind of not-so-subtle reference to Caesar and to the Roman imperial behavior with respect to Jerusalem, because by this time it's pretty clear what's going to happen. So Jesus is talking about the end of their world, and their world does end. It twitches and gasps after the destruction of, at the end of the Jewish War, so which finally ends about the year 75 with the destruction of Masada. There's a period of time where the corpse of the old world twitches around for a while and has one more spasm, and there's another, what we call the Second Jewish Revolt, which is in the year 120, 130, something like that, and led by a guy named Bar Kokhba. That's what they called him, Bar Kokhba. His name was actually Bar Kozba, but they called him Bar Kokhba, son of the star. And he was the last messianic pretender of that age. And that was the end. No more revolts after that. The end, completely the end of whatever that way of life was, gone. And instead we get the development of new ways of life, new ways of being. Now we would say Jewish, truly. We mean that in the cultural religious sense, no longer in the geopolitical sense. New ways of being Jewish in a non-Jewish world. And the rabbinic way of being Jewish starts to take hold. The end of their world. Worlds end all the time. But the reason we read that text and we don't necessarily find ourselves identifying with that first century destruction is because we recognize a kind of universality to it. It's like a cycle. It's just over and over again. It's just the same thing over and over again. It's like we can't get over war. It's like we can't... We always think that peace is on the other side of the next war, you know? That just one more, we just have to defeat this enemy and everything will be okay. We just have to put down these people and everything will be okay. Once we get rid of them, everything will be fine. And it never works that way. Have you noticed that? It never does. And when one country starts to get it, when we're like, you know what? We should maybe not be like... Then all of a sudden some other country's attacking, and then we have to step in again and try to stop someone from doing something terrible because, you know, if we just get rid of those people, if we just get rid of that enemy, everything will be fine, that finally there'll be peace, as if God is just waiting for us to have a war so that, you know, finally the kingdom of heaven can arrive. And what we have Jesus saying is something that I find really interesting. He says, if it wasn't for the fact that God cut short those days, there would be nothing left. And I keep thinking, what does that mean? How does God cut short those days? And I'm thinking that maybe by us, right? What does Jesus say? He says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. I'm beginning to think that maybe the thing that makes it so that we haven't destroyed ourselves yet is because there are people who keep saying, you know, if we love one another, that might work better. People who keep saying, you know, we've defeated that enemy, but we don't need to humiliate them. We can actually turn them from an enemy into a friend, which is what we did after World War II with Europe. There are people saying, you know, if we hate a class of people for the behavior of a small group of people, then it only makes it worse. We actually radicalize those people. So if there are people who are poor and are struggling in America, and we start to look down upon them and say that it's their fault that they're poor, we start to radicalize them. The next thing you know, they're white supremacists, and they're part of the growing body of white terrorism in America that the FBI is concerned about right now. Or if we do that with any group, we start to create the very thing we're trying to supposedly eradicate. But if we say, hey, let's love our neighbor, let's work together for peace, let's make that happen, maybe we are the very mechanism whereby those days are cut short. I don't know that the cycle will not keep going, but I do think that we are put into the cycle in order to speak another word. I'm not saying that, you know, we should never go to war or anything like that. I recognize that, you know, when somebody goes to war and fights for the country, what they're doing is honorable and important work. And I know that sometimes it's necessary to stop crazy guys like Hitler and stuff like that from doing terrible things. I get that. At the same time, the same voices need to be voices of peace, voices of hope, voices of a different possibility. In order to cut short those days. That's what I'm thinking. So, you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, that you don't believe we're on the brink of destruction. I suspect you and I, and the good news of forgiveness, grace, and love, is the very thing that keeps us from falling over that brink. Can you find the prayer response? And let's pray that together. We hear of war and rumors of war. So with heavy hearts we pray, come, Prince of Peace, shorten this time of destruction and spare your creation. And let it be true of us what you have spoken. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. In your name, amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you. Oh, may your countenance be lifted up. Oh, may God keep you in perfect peace. Peace be unto you. God's peace abide. Be there.